Alright, let's see what we got here today.
Hello, noble ones. Welcome back to my channel. This is the Metatron speaking. Today's topic is a rather exceptional...
Hey guys, welcome back. I'm Ian Laspina, and if you didn't pick up on it from my intro, today I have the honor of working with one of my favorite historical YouTubers, Raffaello Urbani, or as he's better known on YouTube, the Metatron. So what we wanted to do today was kind of address some of the myths and misconceptions out there surrounding mobility in armor. There's a lot of strange ideas that have become kind of ingrained into the popular mindset that armor is too heavy to move in. Once you're in it, you're just too immobile to really fight effectively, or you need ridiculous things like a crane to be able to get on the back of a horse. Well, we thought it would be a cool idea to kind of bring two different styles of armor together and show you some of the things that you can and cannot do once you're inside of that armor. Now, if you're a regular viewer of my channel, you know that my focus and my personal armor is based on late medieval Western European culture, whereas Raffaello is the owner of a very nice feudal Japanese era samurai style harness. So we thought it would be nice to show you a kind of a compare and contrast of how these two armors match up with each other, as well as how they meet up with your expectations of what you can and can't do in them. Now, I know what you're thinking, and we're not here to add fuel to the fire and the whole deadliest warrior, knight versus samurai, katana versus longsword kind of fanboy debate out there, because that never really bears any historical fruit, and you know that that's not what our channels are about. So one of the most important things you can do during this demonstration is keep in mind the context of these armors. They're very different armors built for different cultures in different time periods to face different threats on the battlefield, used with different types of tactical preference, and what they were not designed to do was fight each other. So what we're gonna do now is take turns describing our personal harnesses and in order to be able to put those armors in context for you. And then we've come up with a list of different mobility drills and some basic tasks so that you can see some of the things that you are capable of doing in these armors. And we'll do that side by side so you can see them simultaneously. And then afterwards, we'll each give our own analysis of what we were feeling and what we felt, what we saw during the demonstration. If you're watching this on my channel, you'll get my perspective as the guy in the European style harness. And then I encourage you, when you're done with that, go over to Raffaello's channel if you haven't already and take a look at his video so that you can get his perspective as the guy wearing the Japanese style armor. All right, so let's get started and take a look at these armors.
Here is a picture of my armor, which is a Tosei Gusoku, or modern armor. Culture, Far East, Japanese. Time period. Well, my armor is a classic 1582 to 1600 kind of armor. So we are in the Sengoku period, or Sengoku Jidai, which was a period of near constant military conflict in Japanese history. Weight. The weight is roughly speaking around 52 to 57 pounds, more or less. Now, traditional samurai armor, which was called yoroi, hung down from the shoulders, but the most noticeable difference between Tosei Gusoku and traditional yoroi is in fact the tailoring, considering that Tosei Gusoku tapered at the waist and was designed so that the hips would share most of the armor's weight. Intended use. Again, differently from previous samurai armor sets, which were designed for mounted combat and sometimes mounted archery as well, the modern armor, or Tosei Gusoku, and specifically the Okegawa Do, which was the most popular kind of armor, was lighter and more flexible, and simpler versions started to be also used by foot soldiers, which were called Ashigaru. Weapons. As far as the weapons that this kind of armor was designed to withstand, of course, we have spears, the kanabō, a spiked club, swords, arrows, but also, interestingly enough, this armor was built with arquebus in mind, and many Okegawa Do suits went out onto the battlefield displaying dents because they had been tested against arquebus balls.
Alright, so here's a shot of my armor. Culture, late medieval, Western European, as we said before, with stylistic leanings toward England specifically. Time period, turn of the 14th, 15th century, so centered right around the year 1400, with maybe give or take 15 years to either side of that. Weight, 60 pounds total. The male shirt that I'm wearing under the armor is the heaviest individual component of that. And one thing to keep in mind is this type of armor is very well distributed, and the bulk of that load is borne on the waist and hips for comfort. Intended use. Like I said, my harness leans toward English styling, and at this point in history, that means that certain features on that armor are optimized for fighting on foot, like the fully enclosed cuisses, the thigh armor, and the fully articulated from shoulder to wrist arm harness. Weapons. So some of the weapons that this type of armor could expect to see on the battlefield, both used against it and used alongside it, would be things like lances, the poleaxe, various types of swords, crossbows, and longbows. All right, so let's talk about what we saw. What I'm gonna do is rerun the video in miniature, and then I'll kind of narrate what I was feeling as the guy in the European armor, the things that were I was feeling were the most restrictive or least restrictive or whatever. And one thing I do want you to keep in mind, probably critical to keep in mind, is I don't want you to watch the video and then try to extrapolate to all European harnesses or all Japanese harnesses based on what you see here. These are just representative of very specific configurations of armor in two very different cultures. So don't go saying, oh, I saw Ian do this, therefore you can do this in late 15th century Milanese harness. It doesn't work that way. All right, so starting the video here with the first series of the arm range of motion tests, what I found for me, the biggest factor in limiting my range of motion was not the plate components, but actually the male shirt, specifically the lack of gussets in the armpit, the lack of tailoring in the armpit of the male shirt was what was preventing me from getting my arms too high overhead. Higher end male shirts from historical examples have gussets in the armpit to allow that expansion when you get up overhead. Reaching across the chest, we ended up with about the same range of motion here, and that's dictated by how wide the cutouts on your breastplate are, and these are about normal, what you would expect for historical armor, reaching about to the elbows. Once you start to get that unnecessary range of motion, you start to seriously compromise the breastplate. The straight leg swing. So the straight leg swing is just kind of a test of hip mobility in harness. And again, here I'm just barely above parallel, whereas Raphael can get significantly higher. And what I was feeling was the lack of expansion in the male skirt. More of a reproduction error than anything else. The kneeling, not really a problem for either one of us. Perfectly comfortable to get down on one knee and recover under one's own power without any assistance in either style of armor. Kneeling on a stool requires a little bit more range of motion, say, than kneeling on the ground. Getting the leg up, no problem. Requires less power than getting up off the ground, though. Stepping up onto the stool, so demonstrating that under your own power, you can easily use one leg to propel yourself up into a saddle, no crane necessary. Sitting down, getting up, no problem. Again, once the amount of weight on your body is not so incredible that once you've stopped moving, it's hard to get back up again. The vertical jump. So the vertical jump is not being really, for me, it wasn't being restricted by my mobility at all. It was really just a matter of being able to develop the power in your legs to jump with 60 extra pounds. That was really what was the challenge there. This one's interesting. So getting up from your back, obviously both of us could do it. Mine is a little bit slower because I found that it would be very difficult to get up the same way that Raffaello did. It was a lot faster and easier for me to roll onto my stomach first and then get up. Jumping jacks, no real problems there. Push-ups, you'll notice that Raffaello is able to get full depth on the push-ups. I do get a little bit of binding of the male again at the shoulders and the armpits, and that was again my limiting factor. For the movement portion, the walking obviously not an issue. If you can't walk with the extra 60 pounds, then you'd have a hard time getting the armor on in the first place. Jogging and running. So the motion of the armor itself is not restrictive enough to prevent you from getting a jogging stride. It's just, again, a matter of running with the extra 60 pounds. Running, same thing. So you're able to run and get kind of a normal running gait. If you tried to do a really wide stride on a sprint or something like that, you may start to run into some issues. But again, the primary issue with running and jogging is the conditioning of the individual underneath being able to run with 60 pounds of extra of extra metal all over their body and the heat that you're building up as a result of it, not so much the physical restriction of the armor itself. So how did I feel overall? Well, I went into it with the assumption that the Japanese style armor was going to be more mobile than the European style armor. And to some degree, it showed that that was true, but not to the difference that I really expected. They ended up being more similar in range of motion than I thought, especially not to the point where one was so dramatically different that it would make or break your ability to fight. Both are definitely suited to be able to fight on foot. When I look at two different contrasting cultures like feudal Japan versus medieval Europe, the things that I always find most compelling in that discussion are really the parallels and the similarities, as opposed to the more obvious contrasting differences between the two, because I think it speaks to the shared component of the human condition and the way that we tackle problems, even in isolated cultures that are isolated from one another. So what do I think caused the differences that we did see? Two things for me. The style of the limb armor on the European style harness is definitely more encasing of the entire limb than on the Japanese style armor. Now, that is definitely going to affect things like the major joints in those limbs, so elbows and knees. I'm willing to bet that Raffaello is definitely able to get a little bit more elbow bend and a little bit more knee bend, especially with enclosed cuisses like I have on my armor now, than I'm able to get in the way that the European armor works. But really, for me, the biggest factor in my ability to move freely was the male shirt. My particular reproduction doesn't include the more subtle tailoring that you see in higher end examples. There are examples of lower end male shirts and male hauberks and things like that that do not include as much tailoring as some of the higher end stuff you see in the Wallace collection, but that would definitely make a difference. And what I'm talking about specifically are expansion gores in the skirt, which would considerably increase leg and hip range of motion. And then the big one for me was the shoulder range of motion, the binding that I was getting at the shoulder, and that is primarily due to the lack of an armpit gusset, so basically an expansion pocket in the armpit that as the shoulder moves, it has more material. Since mail doesn't stretch like fabric does, you need to tailor it in a way to mimic stretch through the use of expansion gussets. And you see that on the higher end shirts and also pockets at the elbow to allow a little bit more range of motion there. So when I do make the switch over to a tailored set of male sleeves and a proper discreet male skirt, I'm definitely eager to kind of revisit that and see what type of difference it makes, if it starts to close that gap between what we saw between the European and Japanese style harness a little bit more. That would definitely be interesting to me. Now, I've never worn Japanese style armor in my entire life, so I have no idea how differently it feels to what I'm used to feeling in European style armor. So here is the link to Metatron's channel, and he'll have this video over on his channel, but he's gonna give you a much different perspective, give you a different intro, and then his conclusions are going to be based on what he felt as the guy wearing the Japanese style armor. So please head over there and check out what he has to say. If you're still with me here, thanks for watching. If you enjoyed the video, give me a thumbs up. Subscribe if you haven't already. And if you have any questions or comments, please leave those down in the comment section below. All the social media links and stuff like that are in the description. And until next time, thank you. Bye.